lunch in Agora. You probably ask, what is Agora? Agora is an old place in Athens between 7th century BC to about 3rd century BC. It was an assembly place, very unique for business, social affairs, religious arrangements. Everything happened in Agora. I could compare to Farid Zakaria's global GPS. You are familiar with him, GPS. Only global, I would define in time and space, not only now, but in the from the very beginning, from Big Bang up to now. And so we will be discussing problems of philosophy and how philosophy came into being and how unique discovery of philosophy was in our Western culture and civilization. I don't want to say that it is unique to the West, but the way it was introduced is very unique. I will be talking about how it started, and I will be also reminiscing some of my recollections, like today is about 50 years since I delivered first lecture in philosophy, half a century. And approximately it was probably 1-2 days before. It was 50 years ago, 63, time of McCarthy. Some of you remember him. And it was not easy to talk about ideas, you know. And especially since I came from a country which was communist. And so I was called, he must be a communist because he's talking about things, you know, we are not familiar with. And so it was not easy, you know, to introduce philosophy in Alaska. The president told me, we never had it, we don't need it now, we will never have it in the future, just forget it. Can you do something that makes sense? You know, so my God, President Patty. You know, I asked him what he understands under making sense. And he says, we need languages. Foreign languages, Russian, I speak Russian. He called a Russian professor, examine him. So I was answering questions, and the Russian said, his Russian is good, he is not Russian, he speaks it with some accent, you know. And, yeah, but his Russian is good. What else can you do, young man? No, I can teach German. He called a German to examine me. He said, German is very good, you know. No problem, you know. I have a PhD in German. I had to write a dissertation. He said, okay. Forget your damn philosophy. You get a contract for 9 months for $7,100 for 9 months. Take it or leave it. Take it. Now, but on the condition that I forget the philosophy. This was President Patty, a minor, you know. You wouldn't be surprised that he did not care for it. But this was the atmosphere at the University of Alaska at that time. So 50 years ago. I'm very fortunate that I have students like you, over 50. When I started, I had youngsters. And a few weeks after my first lectures, I had already reverends in North Pole discussing my comments. My students had parents, went home and mentioned that I have challenged St. John. A student asked me, what do you think about St. John? What do you think about Jesus? I'm a great man, great man. What, nothing else? I'm a great man. What about St. John? And his statement, I think he was mistaken. Why he was mistaken? So I explained that when he said at the beginning was the Word was God, and the Word was by God. I said, St. John was mistaken. And the students, at the beginning, there must be an idea. The Word is a proxy for the idea. Of course, students did not understand exactly what I was trying to explain. They went home to North Pole and said, oh, this communist professor is challenging St. John. He said that he is mistaken. St. John. So the reverends use it in their sermons. And in the meantime, Dr. Wood became president. He arrived the same time with me. Dr. Patty was retired. And Dr. Wood called me and asked me, you know, it was brought to my attention that you are challenging some of the leaders of our Christian religion. What happened exactly? I don't know, but they are very disturbed. You know, can you tell me what kind of crime I have committed? And he said, he had forgotten it. So next time I will tell you. So he called me about 1 week later, he told me about St. John. If it is true, yes, it is true. You really challenge St. John? He's a saint. You know, I think I challenge his statement. I don't want to offend him, you know, as a man. He's a saint, don't you understand? So I try to explain to Dr. Wood that before you say anything in any language, that all sayings are proxies. When I say something in German, it is a German proxy for what? Russian proxy, English proxy for some idea. And Dr. Wu told me, this is what you understand under philosophy. It is out of my mind, you know. I would never let our young generation listen to something like this. I'm very sorry, but I hope one day you will understand. And he got upset. It was unorthodox. To talk with president this way, to challenge a saint, so it looked like I will never have a chance to teach philosophy here. Since I started organizing immediately with help of people in geophysics, in sciences, Department of Philosophy. Courses in philosophy were in those days taught in English department, Introduction to Philosophy only. Dr. Wood was also professor of English. So he told me, everything we need in philosophy is taught by professors of English. Everybody has to be able to teach a course in Introduction to Philosophy. So I went to English department, and there was a great lady in department, had Minnie Wells. Is there anybody who remembers Minnie Wells? A great lady, medieval scholar. I asked her if it is true that they teach the whole of philosophy, and she told me, come with me into my office. You know, this is not philosophy. It is in the United States in English departments, we believe that that philosophy is a book. We teach books. So when I get book in philosophy, I can teach it. Introduction to philosophy. I know this is not philosophy, but you know, you are not from here. This is how we are used to. Every instructor in English department can teach a book, philosophy book. So I made an offer if she would release philosophy, and that I am trying to organize philosophy department. So we became very good friends, and she said yes, but not openly. So the others were not supposed to hear it yet, but we were holding hands. And we lived in Stuart apartments. She lived once story above me. So we became friends, and I got full support for that. So it took me about 1 year, 2 years. At 63, I was able to teach logic. Nobody in English department could teach logic. So this was the first course. Logic was in the meantime assigned to be taught by Department of Mathematics. So there was another problem, you know, how to get logic from Department of Mathematics. Luckily enough, the man who taught logic was just finishing his PhD in philosophy, writing a dissertation on David Hume. And as soon as he learned that I'm going to organize Department of Philosophy, he came and offered to help. And department head, who was also my friend, told me, I give you the position. So before the department was organized, I already had a tacit position. So 50 years ago, still going. I am fortunate to have students like you. You won't go home and tell your parents because you have lived your life. And this is the ideal age, you know, to study philosophy, because you don't need books. You have lived your life. So this is where I'm going to start. I will be talking about what is philosophy, its emergence in the history, and how after millennia of development of humanity, there was one nation which started this very field called philosophy. It carries their name because they had right after their invention to call it in Greek, philo, philosophia, phil, love, sophia, wisdom. So there are many words which are kind of jargon for people who don't speak Greek, but they had full right to use their language, you know, their proxies for ideas they had. And it started around 7th century, 6th century BC. There had many other happenings before, but it was in Greece where this very activity called philosophy started. Therefore, many names in philosophy, later in all other fields, in science, in medicine, are Greek roots. So don't get disturbed by it, because this is no jargon. This is the right of people who invented ideas call them by their name. Late Romans learned some of these ideas and started translating them into Latin, because they could not take that, you know, that somebody could use in their little nation. So they translated it into Latin. Anthropos, no, homo. So we have double roots, and these double roots appear in all Western languages, either in Greek or in Latin. So I will be using these terms, and I know you are too old to be disturbed that I'm using jargon. And there are just no other better description than to use this very notation, and also the search, the ideas Greeks had and later Romans, partially, Romans only partially. Romans were different people. In my attempt to simplify our Western development of ideas, I have been using in the last 50 years three sources out of which our very nature, Western nature, consists. The first is Jewish, which gave us tradition of religion. Religion is derived from Latin word religio, relationship. Relationship with God, with Yahweh. So, Jewish concept of religion is a detailed elaboration of relationship with Yahweh. Practically all activities of Jewish mind gives us detailed description of what, how we stand with him. Greeks had different tradition. They had their polytheistic religion, their mythology. You know. They had hilarious gods. You know, their gods were just like human beings. They cheated, you know, they got drunk, you know. Of course, don't be surprised that in due history, there will be somebody who will figure out that when these gods are just like us, couldn't it be the case that we made them, that are our gods? And of course, after all these great traditions of polytheism, many gods, there was one man who, in my view, is one of the greatest thinker of antiquity. He suffered for it, and he could not stay where he lived. His name was Xenophanes. About 580, roughly 6th century BC. It was Xenophanes who challenged the way of thinking of Greeks, this whole polytheistic tradition, which was represented mostly by two great men, Homer and Hesiod. Homer with his Iliad and Odyssey, and Hesiod with his works about gods. So these were scholarly and literary monuments, just like Old Testament for Jewish people. These were the monuments of Greek polytheistic culture. Hesiod challenged it. He lived in Asia Minor. We know very little about his life. He escaped and spent his life in Sicily, in exile. He could not stay with the people around him because he challenged what they deeply believed in. What is basically the challenge? I became acquainted with him when I was 18 years old. And I sensed that here is a man, even nobody emphasized him. For me, he was kind of the first man who came as a sober man among drunks. And I did not dare to say it. It's coming. After he challenged the roots of Greek tradition, Trojan War, all explanation of Trojan War, poetically, historically, mythologically, when everything is done with gods holding hands, you know. And this Xenophanes looked at it and said, we produce our gods. We are making our gods. He gave us a theory called anthropomorphism. Man made. Anthropos, man. Morphein, to create. Man created. So the whole mythology is man created poetry, which helps to organize people. But you don't say that it is man's made. Hand in hand with by the way, today we call it anthropic principle, anthropic. So it is anthropomorphism of Xenophanes. The second theory of mine, he called hypostatization. Hypostatization, which means I take something from my mind, I send it out, and I found it. Oh, it's book. So I create anthropomorphically something, send it outside, and go and find it. It's a cap. What is within these two theories, anthropomorphism and hypostatization, is the basic theory explaining our mind. It has implications for everything, for our science. Our science gives us scientific descriptions, projections of the mind. Now we can misunderstand and find our science out there, forgetting with Xenophanes that it is we who put it in. In 20th century, there was a statement my students liked. Change your mind, you change your world. They did not connected with Xenophanes. But it is everything in Xenophanes. Men from 6th century BC gave us penetrating insight into human mind. Now, when you have these two traditions, Jewish tradition is based more or less on source coming from outside, from burning bush, which gave us all essential knowing we can live by. Burning bush is outside. And you know how it happened when Moses went in despair after they escaped from Egypt. And when he saw what his people were doing, he was just annoyed. He must have been thinking, had I known that, I would have let you, as long as there was whip above them. The whip organized them. This is a very important finding. What happens when the whip disappears? It dissolves the society. As far as you know, Moses, in despair, he found the solution. It came from outside. It is the source from outside which is the central idea according to which you can organize people, how to live, where from, where to. Everything can be organized. And it was, Jewish tradition gave us detailed description of it. Now, let's jump to Greeks. Xenophanes found burning bush in human mind. And from human mind, there was a long way into something what we call nowadays consciousness. Something what was very difficult to acknowledge. We had all restraints just to acknowledge consciousness. We had our science, which ridiculed secondary qualities. Paid attention only to primary qualities, which are out there, not knowing that there are. So it took until 20th century, probably last 20, 30 years, when we seriously talk about consciousness. Something what is so self-evident. I could not talk about your consciousness. You better take care of yours. But we know that it is. It is within us. We try to suppress it. We had experts who tried to treat us, who tried to heal us from outside. I remember in the middle of 80s, last century, I wrote a paper for Wittgenstein conference in Austria. Return of consciousness and its implication. I was almost stoned, you know, by my friends, philosophers from all over the world, you know, who were under influence of behaviorism. This was not scientific. Are you aware that this is not scientific, what you are talking about? Then we had rise of artificial intelligence. Finally, we found a way artificial intelligence will take over. The self-confidence, you know, of people like Minsky and Carmecati from MIT, great institution. And they came up here, Minsky came up here, he was in my seminar, and he introduced himself. I am Einstein of artificial intelligence. And I dare to say, Professor Minsky, don't you exaggerate a little bit. What? He got upset. And students enjoyed it, you know. He was in forefront of artificial intelligence. At that time, there was a man, momentarily I have forgotten his name. I knew him very well. He wrote a book, What Computers Do Not Know. He was professor at in Berkeley. And 10 years later, he wrote another book, What Computers Still Don't Know. Of course, Professor Minsky, at the beginning, was upset, you know, that somebody, you little philosopher from Alaska, you know, this is the way you talk. You have no idea what we do at MIT. It was very difficult to get, you know, how to get into consciousness. How to describe it? It can be done only by myself, by yourself. The methodology is, I don't have access to your consciousness. But we have the whole profession in our society, which is based on, I have a license. Here is a couch, you know. I will help you. $250 an hour. So now I think it is difficult to deny that there is consciousness. Each of us have it. And it is within the realm of consciousness that all things human happen. It changes the whole picture. It was Xenophanes who paved the way for this very view. But it took almost 3,000 years, you know, to accept it. And now, I told you about two sources, Jewish, burning bush outside, Greek, burning bush here, and we will start inventing something. And they did. They gave us culture, culture of consciousness, of human heart, of empathy, tragedy, comedy. See, they gave us deep insight into consciousness, not calling it deep insight into consciousness. They gave us great dramas of human consciousness, of human heart. They gave us amphitheater where they performed all these great events of culture. They gave us philosophy. They gave us science. They gave us politics, ideal politics, which, because of human nature, failed. Their concept of democracy failed, just like ours is failing. It is human nature. They face problems of human nature. Now, we have the third source, Roman source. What do we get from Romans? I call it civilization. Civilization is based on a root civil. civilian. Basically, civilian lives next to another civilian. They have 5 kids. The community grows. What do you need in order to supply growing community? You need water. How to get the water? You have to bring the water. So you organize how to bring water into these new settlements, which grow very rapidly. What goes in goes out. Where there are so many people, they don't satisfy their need with water. They have to get rid of it sometimes. So you need a system of canalization. You see, engineering in making, to take off supply of water, to take care of disposal of former water. This is what Romans were working on. Next to it, you need road system. They started building roads. Engineers again. They gave us concept of engineering and how to manage the environment for full satisfaction of people. They were great masters of it. Next to it, there are people who reside in territories which they don't know what they do with it. We can just go and take their territory. Let's go against Etruscans. They did to Etruscans something what Assad is doing to his own people. Only they were more generous. They killed all males and took women and children, moved them to Rome. Rome was growing. Etruscans were the first ones digested by Romans. Hand in hand, this military complex of Romans needs new targets. So, first ones, Carthaginians, on the north coast of Africa. How to get to Carthaginians? Carthaginians came very close to Rome. Hannibal came very close to Rome. He almost occupied Rome. He was defeated. He had to move his elephants. You know, this is not the fastest vehicle you have. He had to retreat all around the Mediterranean Sea back to Carthage. Roman engineers were thinking, now we have military complex, well-organized army. We have to build a road via Appia. From here, we can jump over and destroy Hannibal. So they did. They destroyed Carthage, and in order not to have anything grown ever in Carthage, we will cover it with salt. There won't be any more attack from Carthage against us. The slogan of Roman civilization was Carthago delectam est. Carthage has to be destroyed. And destroyed in such a way that it will never stand up again. Now, Cartage is 7. Another road, Via Brindisi. Via Brindisi to a city, Brindisi, will be built for an attack against Greeks. So, road was built, the army was able to march to Brindisi by boat. They defeated Greece, which was militarily very weak. But there were Romans already who fully understood what Greeks produced. There was one of them, one of the leaders, his name was Cato, C-A-T-O, the older. After they defeated Greece, he came to Athens and proclaimed his famous Graecia capta ferum victorem cepit. Victorious Rome was defeated. Ferum victorem. Victorious Rome was defeated by power of Greece, culturally. You see the insight? Somebody who is proud of great victory, he sees Greece is finished. And he says, we have defeated you, but you have defeated us culturally. There were not many Romans who were able to say this, you know, because they were so proud, another country finished. So this was Rome. Roman civilization gave us concept of engineering, concept of law, according to which the territory will be organized and administered, and wherever Roman Empire will move, Roman law will help to administer the new countries. So law, military, engineering walk hand in hand. Rome needed more and more soldiers with increasing territory to be occupied. They needed more and more soldiers. Where do you take soldiers from? Have you seen some rich people ever to enlist? I know. You go to agricultural workers, not knowing that you are destroying your agriculture. You are bringing these simple people, making soldiers out of them, moving them to another territory, just boosting their pride. You know, there are no more village boys. You know, they are really experienced warriors. They would never go back to village. You see the social change of empire. Now you have more and more soldiers. You have more and more administrators. You have more and more people who want to live, who have to be entertained. So you build Colosseum for them. You build Super Bowls just to make them busy. You create a new class of fighters in Colosseum. You know, I studied the foundation of Colosseum when I was about 28 years old. I was so fascinated what went on, you know, below the stage. It was illegal to get there, but once when it was raining a little bit, I got in, you know, with a flashlight. I got lost there. But I got a feeling what went on. There were cages for lions. You know, there were rooms for gladiators. And above them was a place for about 20,000 people. Circus Maximus, another place I studied, you know, and tried to figure out what went through the minds of people, of Romans, who built this huge Circus Maximus in Rome. Wherever Romans went, they built a Colosseum all along the coast of North Africa, in Lebanon, in Syria. Why? Because they wanted to entertain their people. Super Bowls everywhere. You have to entertain these people. This was the concept of Roman philosophy called homo ludus. Man who is playing, player. Man is a player. We have other concepts, homo sapiens. And we know that he is less sapiens than what it says. We have not developed him yet, homo sapiens, but it was seriously believed that we are homo sapiens. Homo consumptor, this is today's concept of man. Homo consumptor, yeah, man consumer. 350 pounds, hardly move. And that's the goal. Kids, you know, 10 years old, 120, 140 pounds. Homo consumptor. Our course is based on the concept homo curiosus. Man is a curious being. And so this was Rome. You have three layers: Jewish, Greek, Roman. Out of these three layers, we have the whole Western society. Scrape yourself and you will find these three layers. The one which prevails probably defines your personality. All three played a very important role. We can ask question, what is our American personality? We know we are exceptional, maybe less than exceptional, but what is within these three? Which are the leading features which govern our society? Jewish, from Jewish, religion plays very important role.
So Judaism, Greek, and Roman is what you're saying?
Yes. Okay. Yeah, these three layers are like paint on each of us, you know. You can just scrape and say, you know, this is my Jewish one. Yeah, and Protestant, you know. So and so. I have the other one. What is the prevailing in our when we scrape each other, you know? Which is the basic element out of these three? What do you think?
For individual?
Yes, individual. What do you think?
I'm not sure. I can see elements of all three.
All three, yes. But which one is in today's society prevalent?
Probably Roman.
Roman.
I don't like it,
yes, yeah. Roman, you know, we build Super Bowl. Do you know what is The highest paid profession in the United States.
Highest paid what?
Profession.
Football player.
Football player. Football coach.
Coaches, I'm sorry.
Football coach. Yes. All over the United States, football coach. These are the gladiators. The Roman gladiators.
For the entertainment.
Entertainment. So, critically, we are... Greece?
Yeah. Of course, we're the culture vouchers.
Yeah, you know, we have all three, but you see how Roman we are, you know. The whole entertainment, concept of entertainment which we have. We have to be entertained by TV, by computers, and we cannot stay alone, you know. It's painful to be alone. And so this is the three elements. We have Super Bowls. We have Wall Street, which is a Super Bowl with money. No other culture ever had something what is Wall Street. That's a Super Bowl. Super Bowl when money goes up and down. Just watch the people, yeah, how they stand when they read. You know, completely destroyed and excited when they hear that their stock made it.
When they hear what, I'm sorry?
When their stock had risen. They get excited. Have you watched the Wall Street News? Wall Street News, when people are waiting for the results and how excited they are when they hear and when it goes down. Something, human consciousness is here controlled by certain elements which are elements of this civilization. And so we have inherited from Rome a lot. Now we can ask questions, what happened with Rome? Roman Republic was organized in the 5th century BC, destroyed, you know, 4 centuries later by Caesar, who marched on Rome just to introduce order into Roman society. 44 BC. Roman Empire lasted until beginning of the 4th century. When Emperor Constantine is afraid to live in Rome and moves his center from Rome to Constantinople, his own city built by Constantine, for Constantine, and running the empire from Constantinople. It is just like Obama, who gets tired, you know, and afraid that somebody can kill him. He moves to Santa Barbara and builds Obama City. In outskirts of Santa Barbara. So within 350 years, Roman Empire, with this way of life and values, was finished. Who finished it? Believe in something stronger, which comes from outside, some higher value. People who were sick and tired of these materialistic values. Roman Empire was defeated by former slaves. By the way, the man who brought these former slaves, Jewish slaves, into Rome was Julius Caesar. Julius Caesar was captured by pirates near today's Alexandria. He was kept, you know, as a hostage. He was liberated by Jewish garrisons, Jewish men who liberated him and made it possible for Caesar to return to Rome. Among other things, Caesar was a generous man and he wanted to pay back for his rescue. He opened the door for Jewish settlers to come to Rome. Many of them came. Great part of Jewish intelligentsia came to Rome. The famous Josephus Flavius, who wrote his famous book in which he mentions Jesus, Josephus Flavius. He became a high-ranking man of finance. Jewish intelligentsia was brought from Israel, Palestine, into Rome. So it was Julius Caesar who laid down the foundation for later uprising against Roman values. In due time, Romans were not able to rule themselves. The emperors were decadent, killing each other. And for men in the street, there was one question. The life must have deeper meaning. And if I don't find the deeper meaning here, it has to come from somewhere beyond this society. Roman philosophers were not able to save Rome. They were Epicureans, they were Stoics, but they had no power over the people. People were disillusioned. Somebody has to work for this machinery. You know, for the Super Bowls, somebody has to work 12, 14, 16 hours a day in order to have this kind of order going. Entertainment for upper classes with highest paid people, gladiators. And gladiators risked, of course risked. Many of them were killed by lions. Our today's gladiators are risking too. Many of them are crippled for the rest of their life. Mm-hmm. There was no hope. The only hope was coming from above. And leaders of this new movement were not the best educated people. But they were giving something what at that time was more valuable, hope. And with hope, common man joined them. This was the end of Roman Empire. When I look back, 1776, 1876, 1976, 2076. We are coming pretty close. Can we arrest it? If, how? How can we stop it? Romans could not help themselves. At the beginning of 4th century, when Constantine escaped and built his own city, those who stayed in Rome were afraid of Vandals who attacked Rome. A new empire was in making. Vatican. Battle for territories. Battle for territories, how to Christianize people in the north of Italy. From Constantinople, you have emissaries going all around trying to distribute their form of Christianity. There are so many countries to be taken over. So in next 300, 400, 500 years, these two powers are battling for souls of people in Central, Northern Europe, England, Scandinavian countries. And finally they succeed. They divide the whole European continent into two powers, Constantinople and Rome. It will take a long time before some light can be seen again. Before that happens, there are movements within the Western part. Idealistic movement of liberating Jerusalem. Let's have an army and let's liberate Jerusalem from infidels. Where do you get this new army? From common men, from common people, from peasants. Pull out a peasant out of a village, give him a uniform and a cross, and he will start marching across Europe. The farther he goes, more experiences he is finding among how other people live. He is no more the village boy who used to be limited by the limits of his village. He is now somebody who has seen the world. This is a force which will shake the Christianity from within. These are no more dummies. They will come back and they will tell people. They have seen the world. So this was the cause of later fall of medieval Europe. The other one is Constantinople, when the Turks became organized, moved against Constantinople, later occupied Constantinople. Before they were able to do it, the best people from Constantinople escaped. Where did they go? Who were these people? Artists, theologians, professors, physicians, artists. They went to Venice. From Venice, they went to Florence. This is the beginning of Renaissance. So these people came and planted seedlings of the ancient Greek world into 13th, 14th, 15th century Italy. Out of that came New World. What happened with the other group from Constantinople, which did not go to Venice? They went to Moscow. These were builders, theologians, and they brought Eastern form of religion to Moscow. Thus, Moscow became the third Rome. Rome, Constantinople, Moscow. Continuation of Constantinople will be Moscow. Now we have a new ball game. Constantinople occupied by Turks becomes Istanbul. Hagia Sophia is remodeled with minarets and is a Muslim monument. Collapse of Greek culture, of Eastern Christianity. And the world goes on. New power in the East is Moscow, but Moscow has to liberate itself, you know, from Mongols. They are surrounded by Mongols everywhere. So they have to defeat Mongols in order to establish Moscow Empire. Before it was Kiev Empire. It was Kievik Russia, the center of Kiev. Now it will be Moscow. And Moscow was built architecturally by architects from Constantinople. From now on, we will have in Europe a new tremendous power, growing power of Russia, which starts borrowing Western ideas, because the Eastern Orthodoxy could not sustain their empire. It was Peter the Great who realized, under influence of German engineers who were invited to come to Moscow. They were able to settle down in Moscow, creating Moscow City, German freedom in Moscow, German city in Moscow, with schools and churches, Protestant churches. Peter the Great, a student in one of the German schools, and he likes it. New ideas. There is a world outside in Western Europe. This is the beginning of a great battle within Russian society. Those who look to the West and are excited. Later they are called Westerners. Those who hate the West and try to battle this influence. Russian society is split between Slavophiles and the leadership of the church and the Westerners. Practically all Western, all Russian intellectuals were split between Westerners and Slavophiles. The whole modern history of Russia is conflict of those who want to Europeanize Russia and those who want to preserve Russia on basis of Constantinople Orthodox Christianity. So this is a new power in Western Europe. And with them, in modern era, comes Peter the Great, who decides to build a harbor, a window to the West. He moves into territory which is so inhuman. You cannot do anything there. He forces people. Here I am going to build city of my name. St. Petersburg, and he succeeded. In order to get better acquainted with Western ideas, he goes to Holland. In Holland, he goes with his group from Moscow, incognito. How can you have a man who is
6 foot 6,
yeah. 6 foot 10, you know, probably material for NBA, you know, and who comes, Dutch people were tall people, but he was still taller than they were. And he liked to drink, he liked to dance on the tables, you know, and fighting with people in the taverns. Incognito, Russian Tsar incognito, you know, in Dutch taverns, learning how to mix gunpowder, how to build ships. One day he's told, there is a rebellion against you, Peter. He jumps on a horse and off he goes across. There is no flight, direct flight to Moscow. On a horse, you know, with his people, he comes and he takes a big scissors with him from the Western Europe, and he comes to Moscow and goes to all these popes, you know, and starts cutting, cutting their beards, you know. Can you imagine all these priests? They were so proud, you know, this was the male signature, you know. And Peter the Great goes and cuts the beard. This is his Western Revolution. And he brought enough scissors for all his soldiers to do the same. So this is the introduction of Western way of life, Western way of thinking, into value system of Russia. Since that time, Russia is divided, trying to become part of the West, and it comes closer and closer to the West until they become closely affiliated with Western workers' movement of socialism, of Marxism. And it is Russia which takes over these Marxist ideas and becomes the leader of the international proletariat. You know the rest of the story. It started with Greek values, which became diluted in Christianity. Greeks never had very much to say until the time of Renaissance. What Greeks gave us was concept of man. This is what is Renaissance all about. Discovery of man. You know, Leonardo. That's a man. The paintings. You know, ladies as they really are. No? It is the beginning of the striptease. and nobody will be able to stop it. And this is what is happening in 14th century. Renaissance. Out of that came great upheaval within the church. The church was represented by people who took over and combined the teaching of the church with obsolete ancient science. What?
The teachings of the church with what?
United with obsolete ancient science.
Obsolete
ancient science, which believe that we are the belly button of the universe. Yeah. Everything turns around us. Yeah? Everything turns around us. Of course, we have church in the middle of the belly button, you know, with the Pope and so on. So everything turns around us. There was a corresponding system called Ptolemy. Ptolemy was Egyptian astronomer who gave us geocentric system, explaining that we are the center of the solar system, all planets move around us. Of course, this goes hand in hand, you know, with the mission of the Bible. The Bible is direct extension of this system, so it fits together. Now, what will happen to people who will object to it? Who will look into a telescope? Oh, of course, you have to figure out a telescope at first. Then church will forbid to look into the telescope. That's a work of a devil. Now, people who kept fighting were punished. One of them is Giordano Bruno. Giordano Bruno, at the end of 16th century, was burned at the stake because of his teaching that we are part of pantheistic universe. We turn around the sun. He paid with his life for his teaching. Galileo, who followed him, was a little bit smarter. He was a little bit afraid of high temperatures. You know? and so, in the decisive moment when he was called in front of the papal council, he agreed that we turn around, that everything turns around us. But then his scientific ego had awakened and he shouted, "E pur si muove, a prece se tocime." This was too late, you know. So, pur si muove. We turn around, not the other way, church claims. Rest of his life he spent in domestic prison. And he saved his life, you know. His fear of high temperatures was justified. But how long can you defend human belief? How long can you defend part of the product of human mind, which is distributed among people, among armies, among power? It is human intellect which succeeded, was in minority, but succeeded. It took time. So we are facing here battle of ideas with values. let me close our tour through our Western history and history of ideas. I have mentioned Edith Hamel. She gave us an encyclopedia of myth, mythology.